Hello everyone, this is Luz Roncal from the Basque Center for Applied Mathematics and Iker Basque in Spain. First of all, I would like to thank the organizer of the Fourier Restriction Online Conference in 2021. Today I'm going to present my joint work with these people here about directional square functions. So first I will introduce some motivation for the problem that we are going to study. And this motivation comes from the work by Charles Fermat in 1971 concerning the multiplier for the ball. So this operator is this one here. So in the Fourier side, this is defined like this. This is the characteristic function on the ball. So this is the multiplier for the ball. And what Fermat proved is that this operator is bounded only on L2 for dimensions higher or equal than 2. So the idea of the proof, no, or to disprove the boundedness for other values of p, it's a conditional result that is as follows. So assuming that we have the boundedness, say for p bigger than 2, then this argument that is due to Meyer says that if we consider a sequence of unit vectors in R2, where this collection can be anything, finite, infinite, whatever, then if we take the half space, determined by hj, determined by one of these unit vectors vj, then we have that this vector valued inequality is true. And here, this tj is nothing but the multiply on the half space, okay? So assuming that we have the boundedness of the multiply for the ball, then we will have this vector valued inequality or LP boundedness for the square functions associated to this operator. So just to illustrate a little bit what is the relationship between this multiply for the ball and this TJ, so we have here a picture. So if we fix a direction vj, then the half space that is determining this vj is just this half space. So actually these tj's are nothing but the directional Hilbert transform in the direction of vj. So it happens that if we take now a ball here, no, with this with some center, and then we're getting bigger and bigger balls, it happens that this directional Hilbert transform can be understood like a limit of multipliers on the ball. So with this relation, the idea of the proof in this Meyer's lemma was that actually this square function could can be dominated by the multiplier in the ball, understood in the previous sense. And then what's happening is that, okay, we have then this domination, and now use the hypothesis that there was the multiplier in the ball was bounded, actually a vector valid version of that remains valid. And then this allows you to conclude the result. So what's happening here? That actually this Meyer's result is not true in general, and actually it fails when it's tested on KK sets. From this problem, there are several, there is some motivation, some morals, and then further works that actually motivated our work. So first of all, there is a moral in the Fermat's counterexample and the Meyer argument, and it's that it's clear that there's a relation between the ball multiplier and the square function estimates for certain directional multipliers. So in order to, of course, this work by Fermat opened the door to very deep and fundamental works in the harmonic analysis even up to date, no, concerning Bogner's means, estimates, restriction theorem, and so on. But also, no, that's what I want to focus on is this relation with square functions for directional multipliers. So in this regard, I would like to mention two works by Cordova. So one is in 1982. So he studied a square function for n spaced cones, and he obtained logarithmic estimates with unspecified dependence on the number of cones. Apart from that, there is another result by paper by Cordova in 1977, in which he studied the polygon multiplier. So this can be viewed like a quantification of the failure in Fermat's counterexample. So this work by Cordova, that is concerned the Fourier restriction to a polygon of n sides, actually can be he still gives some estimates. Quantitative, but not precise quantitative estimates, with dependence on the number of the vertices of the polygon. So actually, this has a relation with the ball multiplier because the ball can be seen as a limit of system of polygons. So our aim is to revisit these results, but well, maybe more generally, we'd like to get a new approach to study square functions. In for directional multipliers, so give a new approach, so that it will be abstract and robust enough to improve the results by Cordova in several directions, and to pose more flexible structures, so that better results can be or more general results can be understood into a general framework. So this is what just said, that our goal is to develop a new approach to directional square functions. Our strategy will be built on techniques already developed by Katz and Bateman. In particular, we will have develop two tools that will be abstract. First of all, we will prove some directional embedding theorem for Carleson measures. No, this will be something general. And the idea will be to once we have this directional embedding theorem at hand, we would like to apply this in the context of time frequency analysis of intrinsic directional square functions. So the idea is that the particular problems we are concerned with, that is the square functions for the frequency cones and the polygon multiplier that has to do with the frequency rectangles, is that we will develop first, or we will introduce some time frequency analysis ad hoc for these models of frequency projections, and then we will connect this to Carleson sequences so that we will be able to apply this directional embedding theorem and then get good enough results to deduce the improvements of Cordova's results. So that is what I'm saying here in three. No, the idea is that we will apply to this particular case of conical square functions and directional Rubio de Francia square function. Actually, in this presentation, due to lack of time, I will just emphasize the ideas in the directional Rubio de Francia square functions. I will not even present the results in conical for conical square functions, but well, we also did that. And the point is that once we get the square function, boundedness for the directional Rubio de Francia square function, this will allow us to apply the results to the polygon multiplier, and then we will be able to find new logarithmic bounds for the Fourier restriction to a polygon of n sides. Okay, so these are the results that I'm going to present. So the first one concerns directional Rubio de Francia square functions. For me, these operators are given in by they are defined like this. So here, what I'm considering is just they are smooth projections on rotated rectangles, given a collection of rectangles. So I will provide more details later. So this is a smooth multiplier with the support. I will be in R2, by the way, all the time. So this will be smooth projections on rectangles. Okay, so give me a rectangle in R2. I will take some smooth projections associated to each of these rectangles. So we'll take a collection of rectangles. And for me, this smooth projection on rotated we will rotate these rectangles, whatever it means. And what our first results will be an LP boundedness for square functions associated to these projections. So Or you can see as well, you can see as well like a vector value inequality. So this is a square function because I will take the collection of rectangles, and then I will take the literal to norm for the collection of these rectangles, and then I will study the LP boundedness of this. So we will obtain boundedness for a range of p's between 2 and 4, including 2, but with a specific dependence of the numbers of, well, say, rotations of such a rectangles, okay? And in particular, we'll get a restricted strong type in the endpoint L4. Actually, the idea will be to get this restricted strong type, and then by interpolation we will deduce the rest of the boundedness for the rest of p's. Okay, so this is the first result. And I would like just to mention some observations. Is that actually we are getting restricted strong type because we will be dealing with Carleson sequences, and then as I mentioned, I will present a Carleson embedding theorem, and this Carleson embedding approach fits very well with L4 estimates for wave packet coefficients, no, in time frequency analysis, that give Carleson sequences. So this is quite suitable approach to deal with, and then to obtain restricted strong type in the endpoint as the one we obtain. So So second remark is that analogous results are proven, although I will not present them here, for rough frequency cones and rectangles. Okay, there is always a loss of log terms when passing to rough to smooth. So in these results for rough frequency cones and rectangles, there will be so the quantitative estimate is a bit worse than in the smooth case. But also, I would like to mention that the quantitative results for smooth projections are sharp. Okay, so they cannot be improved, and this is also a nice result. Consequence from our approach. Okay, so as an application of the Rubio de Francia square functions we will revisit. The result by Cordova in 77 related to the polygon multiplier. So the polygon multiplier is the Fourier restriction to a polygon of n sides, and this can be defined like this. So here we have the restriction to a polygon of n sizes, and the result we get is this one. We have that this operator is bounded in LP for p in the relevant range of p's, and we have a precise quantitative dependence on the number of vertices of the polygon. So this gives a quantification of the performance counterexample and the failure of the boundedness of the bold multiplier according to the previous observation that the bold multiplier can be seen as a limit of polygons, okay? And on the other hand, if one tracks the result in Cordova in 77, where he obtained such a result but without a specific dependence here in this exponent. Well, when one tracks this result, his result, one sees that the upper bound is larger than this quantity, low n to the power 5 over 4, when p is close to the endpoints. And this exponent is worse than ours, okay? Let's go to explain which is the strategy, the global strategy to get our results. So in general, for each situation, when I say each situation, is that when looking at the cone frequency cones and frequency rectangles, no, giving rise to spaced cones multiplier and the Rubio de Francia square functions. The idea is to introduce a little page decomposition on each multiplier. So we will need a suitable ad hoc time frequency decomposition. So once we have the suitable time frequency decomposition of each multiplier, then one applies orthogonality estimates for the wave packet coefficients. Okay. So again, this will be abstract estimates, general estimates. I will not present them here. But that can be applied to these different situations. So thanks to these ad hoc decompositions and the orthogonality estimates for the wave packet coefficients that arise, one can see that these wave packet coefficients, actually they are Carleson sequences. And Carleson sequences, in the sense that I will define in a moment. So we will establish a directional Carleson condition on these wave packets, and then we will have at hand this Carleson embedding theorem that will give suitable estimates in the endpoints. So applying these estimates, applying this Carleson embedding theorem to the corresponding examples will allow us to conclude the results. Okay, so I will then present this embedding theorem for the directional Carleson sequences. First, I need some definitions. So since we are dealing with directional stuff, we will fix a finite set of slopes. And then we will just define sets of directions like vectors like this. No, we will be taking slopes from the set of slopes. We will be defining this shading matrix. You will see a picture in a moment. No, for a fixed slope, you have this shading matrix, and for us a parallelogram along the direction S. It's just it's a parallelogram that arises from the action of a shading matrix on a rectangle, okay, whose sides are parallel to the axis. So here is the relevant picture. So give me a rectangle, so that for instance one of the sides is 1, and the other side is just an interval coming from a dyadic grid. So, and then fix a slope given by a direction, and then perform compute the action of the shared matrix on this. So this action of this matrix is just pulling this, or slanted, this rectangle up, so that this is the resulting action of the shared matrix on the rectangle. So this is a shared parallelogram, and this belongs to what I call a shared grid, shared dyadic grid, and there is this slope, that was the one attached to the corresponding matrix. Okay, so which is for us a directional Carleson sequence? Another important concept is the following. So for us, a collection cal L of parallelograms. It's a collection subordinated to another collection, cal T, of parallelograms of a fixed direction if the parallelograms of cal L can be embedded or contained in parallelograms of the dominating collection. So for instance, in this case, the blue rectangles belong to the collection of parallelograms slope 0. It means that they are parallel to the axis, okay, whose sides are parallel to the axis. So this is an example of collection capital cal L that are subordinated to this blue T. So on the other hand, a non-negative sequence of numbers indexed on of parallelograms coming from the shared dyadic grid, we say that this sequence of numbers is an L-infinity normalized Carleson sequence if for each collection capital L, sorry, cal L, subordinated to some T of a collection of parallelograms with a fixed direction. Then we have these two facts. So first of all is that the sum of numbers running on the parallelograms of the subordinated collection is less than equal than the measure of the union of the subordinating parallelograms from a fixed slope collection. And the sum of these numbers, the numbers indexed in the corresponding collection of the dyadic grids are finite. Okay, so this is for us a directional Carleson sequence, and this is the after result. So give me a collection of shared dyadic parallelograms. And then assume that for one of, each one of the slopes, we have that the corresponding maximal function is a weak type PP, okay? And we have a precise quantitative information on the boundedness, okay? So we have that this maximal function that is the supremum over all parallelograms on the collection of parallelograms with a fixed direction. So this is weak type PP. So assuming this, then for every Carleson sequence as defined before, running on the dyadic shared grid, then what we have is that we have this estimate, okay? So this object here is bounded in L, from L1 to L2, say, with strong, say, this is a restricted strong type inequality, with a precise information on the number of different directions, okay? So in order to understand the heuristics after behind this result, or in order to give some intuition, so let's think about the following. We're having an hypothesis on the maximal function. So a linearized maximal function is written in this form, where these subsets ER, capital ER, are subsets, disjoint subsets of the corresponding R, no, in this case parallelograms. And if we write the dual of this operator, this can be written exactly like this, where these coefficients are the measure of these disjoint subsets. So actually these objects are the ones that are appearing in the thesis of our theorem, okay? So actually, when proving restricted strong L2 bounds for these objects, this corresponds to weak bounds for maximal operators related to these objects here, okay? So this will be the point. And so in our case, when we will deal with our particular cases of frequency cones or frequency rectangles, we will be able to describe these objects via time frequency analysis in terms of this kind of objects, and in those cases these coefficients will be nice Carleson sequences that fit in the hypothesis of the theorem, so that we will get boundedness information on them. So let's introduce the time frequency language for our models. Just very briefly, I will recall some concepts from tiles and wavelet theory. So for us, a tile is a set. It's just a set that is given by a time or space component and a frequency component. So the time space will be, in our case, a parallelogram coming from a collection of shared dyadic grids. And then the frequency component will be some measurable set, and in such a way that the uncertainty principle will be preserved. So we will consider L2 normalized wave packets added to the tiles of order m. So there will be collection of functions. And then the intrinsic wavelet coefficient associated with a tile, no, and for a given function good enough, like square function or so on, will be just the supremum over all wave packages of these square coefficients, okay? So we will deal with what I call square functions involving wavelet coefficients. That will be these operators, okay? For me, a square function involving wavelet coefficient will be something like that. And this reminds the shape of the objects we dealt with in this Carleson embedding theorem. Okay, so now this definition will run over a collection of tiles, and this is something abstract, but when dealing with the particular cases, what we will have to do is to describe this collection of tiles with precision. So now I will make more precise the strategy that I presented before. So in each situation, we will get a suitable time frequency decomposition we will get a specific collection of tiles and a specific intrinsic square function in terms of the wave packet coefficients, so that for them we will prove or will be able to prove orthogonality estimates for such a wave packet coefficients. And then what we will have is that with these source estimates, we will deduce that actually these wave packet coefficients are indeed Carleson sequences and that fit in the direction Carleson embedding theorem. Okay, so we will be able to apply our result, and we will be able to operate in the particular examples in which we perform the corresponding suitable time frequency decomposition. Okay, so I'm going to, as I told you, I'm not going to present the result for the conical from the frequency cones. I will go into details to for the directional Rubio de Francia square functions. So in this case, no, the point is that to perform time frequency decomposition associated to this operator. In this case, the time frequency decomposition, the frequency components, will correspond with rectangles, in which we will have to perform Whitney decompositions or two parameter Whitney decomposition, because we'll need the Whitney decomposition corresponding to each of the sizes of the rectangle. So so actually, given a set of directions, we will consider these rectangles after decompose suitably, and then we'll consider rotations of them and translations. Okay, so this will be the frequency components of our tiles. This will correspond to some parallelograms in the time or space part, that they are not, you know, they are not drawn here. But this will be just parallelograms in certain shared dyadic grid. Okay, so this will be our tiles, and then we will define the intrinsic square function associated to these rectangles like this. Okay, and now the coefficients are indexed in the tiles that we have just defined. Okay, so for this intrinsic square function, we are able to prove this theorem. So actually what it happens is that defined like this, these intrinsic square functions are given in terms of some wave packet coefficients, and it happens that for them we can prove orthogonality estimates, or we can apply general orthogonal estimates that we have proven. And then to prove that actually they fit into this directional Carleson embedding theorem. So apply this Carleson embedding theorem, and then we get first this strong restricted strong type inequality in the endpoint in L in P equal 4, and by interpolation we get the boundedness in the whole range of P's. Okay, so this is what I'm just explaining here, that the orthogonality estimates for the wave packet coefficients allow to ensure that they are indeed Carleson sequences, so they we are allowed to apply Carleson embedding theorem to get this result. Okay, so then now what we are going to do, because this is like an abstract result in some sense, we are going to apply this to the boundedness of directional Rubio de Francia square functions. And just to motivate these operators, I would like to say that the baby, although it was a very important and striking result by Rubio de Francia in 85. So Rubio de Francia in 85, he proved little loop inequalities for operators that were defined like frequency projections on arbitrary intervals on the real line. That was like the generalization of the Hardy little loop theory in a very general, in the most general scenario in one dimension. There is a higher generalization by Journay in 85 for n-dimensional intervals with size parallel to the axis. So our goal was or is to prove little loop inequalities for rectangles in R2 with size parallels to a finite set of direction, not necessarily just parallel to the axis. So in what we are dealing with is with directional analogs of square functions for Fourier restriction to arbitrary intervals in the sense that Rubio de Francia proof. Okay, so we are dealing with this direction and the laws of this result. So with the result that just proved for intrinsic square functions for the rectangles, for frequency rectangles, we are able to deduce this result, okay? So we are getting LP boundedness for the square function associated to these rectangles, okay? And the restricted strong type in the endpoint P equal 4, okay? So these results can be deduced then from the previous abstract results. And again, I insist that the important thing here as well is that we have a precise dependence on the number of directions in the definition of our families. So with this result, we can apply this result to revisit the polygon multiplier problem by Cordova. So I recall that the polygon multiplier is the Fourier restriction operator on a polygon of a regular polygon of n sides, okay, so given like this, okay, and this is the indicator on the polygon. Cordova proved that this operator is bounded in LP in a range of p's between 4 and 4, including the endpoints, and he gave a quantification of this boundedness, but with an exponent here that was not specified. So what we are able to prove here is that we are able to give precise information on this exponent that is better than the one that can be deduced when one tracks the result by Cordova. Although it is doubtful to be sharp, okay? And just to give a glimpse of the proof and where we will be using the previous result, the idea is just to consider this polygon with vertices Vj in the unit circle. And then define this Fourier multiplier. That is, first, there is a part in which you have a smooth radial multiplier with support in an annular region. So if you have the unit circle, you have this multiplier supported in an annular region. And then you have a partition of unity on the sphere, in this case in the unit circle, relative to intervals. This is the blue one, with center on the vertices of the polygon, okay? So for this operator, we can prove a decoupling result with a quantitative dependence on the number of vertices. And this decoupling result can be proved or follows from the L4 decoupling result, for example, by Cordova, FFMR, Tony Carberry, and then the smooth combined with the smooth directional Rubio de Francia square function estimates that we just proved in the previous slides. So with this decoupling result at hand, then in order to prove the LP boundedness of the operator, first you have to reduce, to rewrite this operator in terms of these multipliers. Then one applies the decoupling result so that you get some dependence and on the number of vertices, and then you are reduced to this operator on the right hand side, and then you have here a square function. So now, well, actually, no, first of all, actually this operator can be rewritten in terms of directional Hilbert transform like this. So we are reduced to prove a vector value estimate for this composition of directional Hilbert transform, or for the square function operator related to this composition of Hilbert transforms. So for that, we prove a Meyer type lemma, you know, reminiscent of this Meyer lemma that was presented at the beginning when dealing with the ball multiplier. But in this case, this is true. The idea is that for a finite set of directions, then we have this vector valued inequality for directional Hilbert transform, where the directions are indexed in this finite set of directions, okay? So this is proven to be true, and actually we have a quantitative dependence, and actually this dependence on the number of direction is the best possible. So with this lemma, you apply it twice here, and then you compound in a standard way, and you conclude the result for the polygon multiplier. And I think this is everything I wanted to talk about. Thank you very much for your attention. I will be very glad to answer your questions or comments you may have. So, thank you.